Welcome to The Conversation, Writing, the Arts, and the Creative Spirit. This is Sharon Laborde. Thank you for joining me today. In my essays on writing in the last few weeks, I've talked about memoir writing and writing about everyday life. As an example of writing about a personal experience, or what you know, I'm reading an essay today that I posted back in 2011. I hope it gives you some ideas about your own writing. Now for a little atmosphere, fiction, and fantasy. Not long after moving to Northwest Arkansas, I began to regret no longer having a house in what I still consider to be my home state, Alabama, specifically Birmingham, where I grew up. Soon I purchased a house in Southside, near the University of Alabama, Birmingham, and the Medical Center. At one time, the area was primarily residential, but unfortunately, during the 1960s, many old homes were torn down and replaced with apartment buildings, and thus began the deterioration of the neighborhood. Fortunately, the area is now a historic district, and most of the old houses are at least safe from demolition. But sadly, not from neglect. My home fell into the latter category when I purchased it, but I was fired up to begin the renovation process. Built in 1915, the house sits high on the crest of Red Mountain, with Vulcan rising above it in the back, and an unobstructed view of the city lights of Birmingham from the front of the house. A $1 million view, some have said. Ha ha, the money pit, I've replied, ad infinitum. It's a two-story, actually a camelback, craftsman-style home, and is the mirror image of the house next door. Over the years, an enclosed porch and other improvements have altered the look of the house, but it still has architectural appeal. Of course, this has nothing to do with the ghost story I'm about to tell you. I just wanted you to be able to visualize the place. Legend has it that all of the houses on our particular street are located on what was originally part of an ancient Native American burial ground, and perhaps the stories told about ghostly appearances may be attributed in part to being built on sacred ground. I'm not sure if that story is true, but one thing is certain. With 52 steps from the sidewalk to the front door, the house is not for the faint of heart, or those lacking in courage. All of this was either ignored or unknown to me when I purchased the house. I went headlong into buying the place, was delighted with the great deal I had gotten, and my usual pride of ownership kicked right in. The honeymoon, however, was short-lived. The trouble started in the fall of 2007. It was October, a month of significance, I would later learn, and I was alone in the house preparing for bed. I had chosen one of the upstairs bedrooms since extensive work was needed in the master bedroom downstairs. My son, who had moved in, as sons seem to do, was at work, and I looked forward to getting into bed and reading until I felt sleepy. The lamp on my bedside table was on, and I know without a doubt that I was wide awake. I had just settled down to read and felt very much at peace. Imagine my surprise when I heard footsteps coming up the staircase. I heard several steps, a pause, and then two more footsteps. I called out my son's name, thinking he had returned from work early. No response. I heard two or three more steps, then nothing. At this point, I must admit, I was rather frightened. But adrenaline kicked in, and I jumped out of bed and walked out onto the landing at the top of the stairs and saw nothing. I'm a pretty imaginative person, but I knew I had not imagined those footsteps. After great difficulty going to sleep that night, the next day dawned beautiful and clear in Alabama with October's bright blue sky. The night before seemed explainable to me in the morning light. After all, old houses are notorious for making noises. That's all it was, I told myself. Later that morning, I did mention the night's disturbance to a friend who had grown up in the house. "Oh, that's the ghost," she said, and continued to give me a rundown on all of the people who had died in the house, not exactly what I wanted to hear. The footsteps had long been a problem, she told me, along with other unexplained occurrences, and were generally thought to be the spirit of a woman who lived in the house in the 1940s and died there in the master bedroom downstairs, the one I thought I would use eventually since it's on the lower level. Family members in the past seemed to think she was a troubled spirit since she died leaving her young child. I was beginning to be sorry I had asked, but still, I wanted to know all the details. If you believe there is a life after death, perhaps this poor woman's spirit is stuck here for some reason. Maybe the church could have one of those ceremonies and tell her to go on to the next level, I said to my friend. Oh, we've already tried that, she said, several times. Groups of people have even met here and prayed for the repose of her soul. It didn't work. She always causes trouble in October. That's when she died, on Halloween. The little girl from next door came over to trick-or-treat one year and said she saw the lady outside our house up in the air. Then she said the lady had moved to their house. This was shortly after one of the ceremonies to cleanse the house had been held, my friend continued. But she came back. For once, I was speechless. Later in the day, I decided to let it go, not think about it anymore. Ridiculous, I kept saying to myself. It's pure nonsense. I'm not going to let something spoil my pleasure in living in this house. I will be more concerned with the real people in this transitional neighborhood rather than with spirits. After all, no one has ever been assaulted by a ghost. You know what happened next, don't you? The very next night, a replay of the night before. Except this time I heard the footsteps walking around on the first floor before they came up the stairs. Ready to claim my territory, I somehow made myself walk out on the landing, knowing that this might go on night after night. I stood my ground. "You do not live here anymore," I said in a loud voice. "It is 2007. You can leave now." Nothing. Nothing on the landing, nothing on the stairs, no sound. Just like the night before. "There," I said to myself, "that will show those footsteps." Feeling rather sure of myself and somewhat silly, I walked back to my bedroom, wide awake, and thought about what I would do if this continued. I was beginning to feel a little uneasy, and some of the excitement of my new home purchase was beginning to wane. But before I knew it, it was time for my return to Arkansas, and a sense of melancholy descended. This usually happens when I leave Alabama. Yes, I have a good life in Arkansas. However, I have an ongoing problem with homesickness, especially when I'm facing the winter in a more northern state. So on the day of my departure, I felt a little sad and restless and wondered if I'd made a mistake buying the old house. Years later, I must admit I'm still wondering, but from the present perspective, we know how the real estate investment turned out. That was right before the big real estate meltdown, remember? The Wall Street bailout and the worst recession since the Great Depression. Oh, well. If your house has 52 steps from the front door to the street with no back entrance, remember Vulcan is back there, it's necessary to carefully plan every trip out unless you're on the Olympic team. I was preparing to make an initial trip down the steps with a few things, but decided to have one more cup of coffee before I set out. It had been a very hectic few days, visiting with my friends and my children and taking care of the ongoing projects at the house. I poured myself a cup of coffee and settled into my usual chair in the corner of the living room next to the fireplace. The early morning light was just beginning to filter through the windows as I took a few sips of coffee and thought about the drive back to Arkansas. Steam was rising from the cup as I took another sip. Suddenly, I seemed to be enveloped in it, like a fog had come into the room. Looking down at my lap, I saw swirls of smoke circling around the lower part of my body. Boy, did I jump out of that chair. My initial reaction was that the chair itself was on fire. But once I was out of the chair and gazing at it intently, the smoke vanished. What is going on? I must be losing my mind. A trick of the light, I thought. Some strange visual disturbance caused by the sun coming through the wavy old glass in the windows. That's all it was. I poured a fresh cup of coffee and tried to dismiss the whole thing. Without thinking, I found myself sitting back down in the same chair. After all, that's where I sit, just like Sheldon on television. It's my spot. In no time, the tendrils of smoke began to curl around my legs and lap. I was up in a shot. Okay, I thought, I need to load the car and get out of here. I'm not sure what's going on, but obviously I'm too nervous to hang around and try to figure this out. I grabbed two of my smaller bags and walked through the sun porch toward the front door. The entrance to the house has a wooden front door with two locks, plus a wrought iron security door that also had to be unlocked with a key. Checking to make sure both doors were unlocked, I headed down the steps to my car, thinking about how sad I felt about leaving, but in a way ready to go. After putting my two bags in the car, I paused for a moment to look up at the house. It was that perfect time in Alabama when October's bright blue sky was a vivid background for the leaves of gold and crimson. Even with the outside in desperate need of a fresh paint job, the house, with Vulcan looming behind it, pulled at my heart. It felt like home, but I wasn't sure how I was going to resolve the problem of an unwelcome presence and the escalating cost of repairs. Out of breath after coming up those steps, I opened the wrought iron door and grabbed the handle of the front door. I was locked out. Puzzled, I put my key in the lock, a deadbolt, and it wouldn't turn. I remembered checking the locks on the door when I came out and making sure they were unlocked, since I was just going down to the street and right back. How could a dead bolt that had to be locked either from the inside or with a key lock itself? Frantic, I started ringing the doorbell and beating on the door and finally was led into the house by my long-suffering son. How can these occurrences be explained? All I know is that I can't explain it. I simply know what happened and how I felt during that October of 2007. One final note to the story. My friend, who had grown up in the house, said that she knew exactly what had happened and how I felt when I found myself locked out. It had happened to her many times, she said, and her only explanation was that it was the ghost playing her usual tricks, trying to get us out of her house. I'm so pleased you could join me today on Welcome to the Conversation. I'll be back soon with a few more ideas about writing, interviews with fascinating people, and reports on the creative spirit that is alive and well here in the beautiful Ozark Mountains of Northwest Arkansas and Missouri, USA. Until next time, this is Sharon Laborde, cultural editor of Ozark Harvest Radio.
The Ozark Harvest Radio Hour is a production of the Eureka Springs Independent and the Inside Straight and Thanatopsis Club. Richard Pillay, executive producer. Dan Croats, producer and writer. Dr. Sharon Sloan, technical director. Dr. Fred Mayer, Director of Music, G.K. Chesterton, Director of Philosophy and Content, Jane Pillay and Bonifaci Fiacre Gardening Consultants, Luca Brasi, Aquaculture Consultant, Eddie Kiever and the Fabulous Kiever Sisters, Advertising and Sales. The Ozark Tarvis Radio Hour is organic radio, always fresh, always local, and always honest. We are community radio. That means that if you would like to appear on the Ozark Tarvis Radio Hour, we have to put you on. Contact us at the Ozark Tarvis Radio Hour.com, like us on Facebook, or look us up in the telephone book. Until next week, so long and be nice.
One, two, three, four.